Hello, my name is Maciej Gajdzica, and I will talk today about safety critical systems, which are the systems that, in case of malfunction, may cause human death or some other severe consequences like environment pollution or destruction of expensive equipment. To prevent that from happening, we develop a safety critical system using some other techniques than those known from standard systems, including some special techniques for safety. And some of those techniques will be discussed during this presentation. Safety critical systems are common in medical industry, in automotive, railway transportation, avionics, also in nuclear power plants, industrial process control, and military. There are more and more of those systems every year, and someday, maybe one of you will be also working on such a system. And even if not, I hope that this presentation will encourage you to think more about software quality and safety. A few words about me. I am embedded software engineer in Solvit company in Gdańsk, and I have some experience with safety critical systems. I was working on a railway traffic control system for 2 years, then I was working on a medical device for 1 year, and now for a few months I'm working in automotive. In free time, I am blogging on ucgosu.pl. Blog is in Polish. You can also find me on Twitter. From last 40 years as software users, we get used to that software don't work as we expect. We are not surprised that programs crash, they corrupt our data, or even hang the entire system. We, as developers, found this situation beneficial for us because we don't need to care that much about doing everything perfect. We have even this slogan, fail early, fail often, which encourages us to release software before it's fully done to prove that it's useful and to fix everything later. Of course, it's correct approach for most of the systems, but there are some where mistake may be very expensive and we cannot afford that, so we need to do everything right from the start. Uncle Bob many times said that we as software engineers have problems with following norms, using some good practices and standards. We have even trouble to formulate them, and we create software driven by chaos, and that will inevitably lead to some big catastrophe involving software, which will focus on us attention of society and politicians, and will result in some government regulation for software developers. So let's see what already happened in that matter. This is TERRAC-25, the radiation therapy device from the 80s. Between 1985 and 1987, there were 12 of those devices working across USA and Canada. And this is most infamous case of software error, which resulted in human death. There were 6 accidents involving excessive patient radiation, which resulted in death of those patients. And how that happened? TERRAC-25 could work in 2 modes. In electron mode, it created a low energy electron beam that was pointed directly at a patient body. There were also second mode called X-ray mode, where high energy beam was created. Then it went through that filter, and only after that was pointed at the patient. That filter was placed by a special mechanical arm. Unfortunately, it was possible to generate that high energy beam before filter was in its final position. That cost exceeding those prescribed by doctor by 200 times and causing those accidents. Families of the victims went to the court, and expert witnesses analyzed source code, finding exact places responsible for those error. Code was created in the assembly. Here you can see some pseudocode. Those are procedures responsible for configuring the device. On the device head, there were some magnets responsible for generating those beams. And there was some procedure for configuring this hardware. Here you can see call to the magnet function. And in this magnet function, some flag was set. Then in the loop, every magnet was configured. And after that, there was delay for hardware to configure. And in this delay function, we had some ifs. And after the loop, the flag was cleared. The problem was that flag was set before the first magnet and was cleared in the delay of the of this first magnet. So when the program went to configuring second magnet, flag was already cleared. So it was impossible to trigger those ifs, and they were responsible for abandoning the operation when operator changed configuration. That put device in unstable state, where some magnets were configured with old configuration and some with new, and that created the possibility of that accident. But experts were not happy with finding only exact places in the code. They were sure that this is only effect of faulty development process, so they decided to dig deeper. And what did they found? The whole program was written by only one person, which didn't consult his solutions with anyone. There were no code review. Also, he didn't maintain any documentation. There were no requirements, architecture, and so on. But software wasn't the only problem. Also, company decided that they can resign from some mechanical interlocks that didn't make it possible to generate the beam before filter is in the final position. They did it because of faulty risk assessment. They were sure that since now software is responsible for that, they don't need to have additional mechanical interlocks. Also, tests were insufficient. It's enough to say that the device was assembled for the first time in the first hospital where it's supposed to work. There were no prior acceptance tests or other tests. There were only a few integration tests in the process. Also, the reporting of issues were horrible because producer was trying to put all the blame on hospital staff, and they reported some issues even before the first accident. But producer always said that this is because of improper maintenance. As a result, apart from six people dead, there were also huge consequences for the company. They had to pay compensations for families of the victims. Also, their reputation taken a huge blow, and they couldn't sell any new products. And finally, they had to withdraw from medical industry. The second example is Ariane 5 rocket from European Space Agency, which on its first flight in 1996 exploded about 40 seconds after the start. Here you can see a timeline of events that led to that explosion. And as you can see here, after about 36 seconds, the SRI module stopped working. That SRI module was responsible for estimation of position and velocity of the rocket. And when it restarted, estimation of the position was wrong because estimation needs old value calculated in previous iteration and change in small period of time. After reset, it wasn't possible to estimate new position with enough accuracy. That caused navigation system to freak out. The rocket starts to turn rapidly, and as a result, procedure for self-destruction was triggered. As you can see here, there were also backup SRI module that had to take over in case of failure of main module. Unfortunately, both of those modules were exactly the same, running the same code, having the same software error. And in the time that it had to switch, backup module already was reset. Similarly to previous example, there was a special committee of experts that analyzed that accident, and they found out that the reason for that was overflow of 16-bit integer. There was a cast from 64 floating point value to this integer. It overflowed, it raised exception. Exception wasn't code, and that caused system to restart. The code was written in Ada, and the variable was responsible for velocity control. As you can see in this block, there were some values in that module that were checked against 16-bit integer overflow. But at the bottom, there is one variable that wasn't checked, and this caused the accident. But again, experts wanted to dig deeper, and they found out that this particular variable wasn't really needed in that code. It was placed there only because it was copy-pasted from previous version of the rocket. In Ariane 4, that code was working without any problem for a few years. But for Ariane 4, they made risk assessment, and then they decided that because of physical model of the rocket, it's impossible for velocity to be above that integer maximum value. They didn't repeat this risk analysis for new version of the rocket, and the physical model was different, and apparently it was possible to overflow that variable. Also, simulation tests were insufficient because the SRI module were mocked during simulation, and only navigation were tested, but nothing prevented them from using production code for that estimation module and mock only sensor measurements. I can provide you many more examples of costly software bugs, but even after those two, we can clearly see a few things. Developers, as human, make mistakes. Even if they are skilled and experienced, they will still, from time to time, make a mistake. So it's not enough to base solely on their skill to prevent software error. We need something more. We need a development process that forms a safety net around the developer so he can be confident that if he makes a mistake, it will be catched by some phase of this development and won't slip into the final product. That's why software standards were created. Here you can see a list of standards for various domains. We have industrial standard, medical, automotive, nuclear, railway, aerospace, and even NASA standard. So the words of Uncle Bob are already true. We already had some big accidents involving software, and we have some limitation for programmers. So now let's see what's inside those norms and what's that development process that will prevent bugs from happening. That process is called V-model, and it consists of three parts: design, implementation, and verification. During design, some high-level concept is created, requirements are gathered, architecture and design is created. Then during tests, we have unit tests, integration tests, system tests, and so on. Then we have verification and validation. And one important part of this verification step is verification by some independent organization. So we eliminate the pressure from the company to release the product before it's fully operational because of some budget or deadlines. V-model owes its V-shape from this, that everything on the left must be verified by something in the right. So implementation is checked by unit test, design by integration test, requirements by acceptance test. Also, design documents from design phase are checked with documents from end of development. And if you expect that process to have extensive documentation, you won't be disappointed by another slide showing names of some documents that are needed in every phase. And here you may wonder, because this process is dangerously similar to waterfall, about which from at least 20 years we know that is not optimal. If we do big design upfront, we cannot anticipate every possible before experimenting. We also defer tests for really end phases of the development that could introduce some additional bugs. So why would we do such sensible devices using development process about which we know that is not optimal? And the truth is not exactly that. And it's described in medical standard, which says that standard doesn't impose on us any particular life cycle. We have some freedom to choose as long as our life cycle includes certain activities and have certain attributes described in the norms, and also creates specific documents. In reality, of course, we do it iteratively. We do some design up front, but we don't try to design everything. We just do as much design as it's reasonable. Another thing is that not every system must have the same level of safety. Consequences of errors of different systems may be different, so some levels of safety were created. Here we have safety integrity level nomenclature, where seal 4 means that if a system with seal 4 fails, life of many people is in danger. In level 3, it's one person life in danger. Level 2 means that severe injury is possible, and level 1 means minor injury is possible. Every level have associated statistical value describing allowed probability of dangerous failure per hour. As you can see, for the highest level, that range is between 10 to minus 9 to 10 to minus 8, which means that when we have thousands of devices in the field and they are working continuously for 10 or more years, it's possible only for a few of them to fail. And for every lower level, we have one order of magnitude lower requirements for that. We have also similar levels in other standards. Here is aerospace standard, which have design assurance levels, which are very similar. Level 8A is the biggest, and it means that failure of this system may cause in death of all of the passengers and losing the aircraft. Level B means that pilots are less capable to deal with adverse operating conditions. Level C, less capable to deal with unfavorable operating condition. Level D, no significant effect on safety. And level E, no effect on safety whatsoever. We have also a medical norm, which have some other naming. Class C is the biggest. And a failure means possibility of death of serious injury of the patient. Level B means non-serious injury possible. And level A, no damage to health possible. And here you may wonder, because yes, we have those hard values describing those classes, but how could we control those values during the project? We cannot measure it anyway. And cannot use some steps to increase that value or decrease. So how could we use that value in our project? And the truth is that we cannot measure it before because we need a complete project and working for some time to measure it. So we need to monitor projects that are already working in the field, gather those statistics, and check which techniques were used to achieve this level of immunity to failure. That's why software norms have those tables grouping recommended software practices. Here we have table from railway norm, where you can see name of the technique in the first column. Then you have reference to the chapter describing more every technique. Then we have column for every safety integrity level and those letters. HR means highly recommended, R means recommended, NR means not recommended, M means mandatory, and dash means it's not specified if it's recommended or not. And as you can see here, there are many, many techniques listed here, and it's not possible to use every one of them in each project. That's why standards are creating recommended sets of techniques for every level. And as you can see here, for table for testing and validation, that for safety integrity levels 3 and 4, approved combination of techniques is 3, which is dynamic analysis and testing, 5, traceability. Traceability is a property of the system that we are able to track the path from forming a requirement then to specific parts of architecture and design responsible for that requirement, then to exact lines of code, and to tests of every level checking validity of that requirement. Then we have 7, test coverage, 8, functional black box testing, and 1 of 1 to 6, formal proof, static analysis, and software error effect analysis. And as you can see, for safety integrity levels 1 and 2, the set is reduced, only traceability and 1 of those 3 techniques. There are some techniques also more related to software. As you can see here, for safety integrity levels 3 and 4, mandatory technique is using coding standard, having some forbidden and recommended software constructs. It's really important for languages like C or C++, where it's quite easy to shoot yourself in the foot. There are also some other restrictions, like no dynamic memory allocation. There are 2 problems with dynamic memory allocation. First one is that it's not deterministic, so we cannot reason about worst-case execution time, and we cannot meet some hard real-time requirements. But the second problem is even bigger, because those systems could work even 10 or more years without a reset, and that may cause huge memory fragmentation, and degradation of performance is hard to predict. There are also some other limitations, like a limited use of pointers, because it's possible to overwrite data of other modules, or in case of function pointers, to execute unwanted code. Also, limited use of recursion. Here you have a list of some recommended and not recommended languages. And the most recommended language is not questionable. It's Ada. That language was created especially for American Department of Defense to write software on supersonic fighters. And if you don't know Ada, I really encourage you to explore that language. The main design goal was to have as many as possible failures that are detected on compilation time. Okay, Ada is non-questionable, but two other highly recommended languages are highly questionable because there are Modula 2 and Pascal. Some ancient languages don't use anymore. Of course, there are no systems currently using those languages. They are here mainly because of some academic research showing that those languages have some features that make them more safe than other. Those features are type safety and not many implicit conversions. Other interesting things are that C and C++, in which most of embedded and safety critical systems are created, are not required more or less than C sharp and Java. And of course, C sharp and Java are safer languages than C and C++, but the main problems here are, of course, dynamic memory allocation and garbage collector used excessively in those two languages. There are also problems with runtime because safety critical systems doesn't run on Windows or Linux. They use specific real-time operating system that doesn't provide a runtime for Java and C sharp. There are also some languages not listed here. I hope no one will ever try to create safety critical system in JavaScript or Python, but there are some languages that are more suited for that. For example, Rust. And I think Rust someday will be a highly recommended language. Probably not more than Ada, but for sure more than C or C++. But we must wait some more for Rust to become more stable, mature, and proven in use. Another thing is providing safety at the system level. The naive approach is to do all of implementation first and think of the safety then. This is doomed to failure because this is like adding tests after implementation or adding documentation at the end. Of course, we can do it, but it will never give satisfactory results. Another naive approach is to create some smaller pieces that are safe and combining them into the safe system. And this is also won't work because safety of modules doesn't imply safety of integration between those modules. So anyway, we must care about safety from the start. And to achieve that, we can do something called risk analysis or risk assessment. And how we do it? During development, testing, designing, documentation, and so on, we exploring system more and more, so we can point out some special cases which may produce some risky behavior. We list all those cases, and then during a risk analysis meeting, we associate every risk with two values. We think, what are the consequences of this event? They could be catastrophic, critical, or maybe negligible. And how probable it is to happen? Is it frequent? Is it probable? Or maybe improbable or eliminated at all? If we have those values, we can put our risk in this risk matrix. and it have some regions. Those regions are correlated with safety integrity levels. And if our risk is placed in that forbidden region, we must do something to either make it less severe, moving it right, or make it less probable, moving it down. And we can achieve this using hardware, software, or people and processes. Hardware is the best approach because it's automatic. It has repeatable results. Also, it's not that complicated, and it fails in predictable fashion. The second best choice is software because it's also automatic and repeatable. It can also provide us more complex logic, but it's really hard to reason about software correctness. And of course, the last resort is people and processes because they are not repeatable. And also, when they are involved in that, they are many times blamed for the accidents. OK, so how those three things work to reduce risks? Common procedure is safe state, where we have our system working normally, and when it detects some error, it goes into the safe state, where it puts all of its outputs into the values where they cannot harm the environment. So for example, it turns off all the engines and so on. And it cannot, by itself, return to operation state. It must wait for the operator, and if operator say it's OK, it can reset the system, returning it into the operation state. And as a side note, I have one piece of advice for you. If you will be creating a medical system and you will be implementing this safe state, don't show to the patient message fatal error. They don't respect. They don't respond too well for that. Okay, but we sometimes cannot use that safe state. For example, if you have a space shuttle, it cannot just stop and wait for the operator to decide. This is a special case for safety critical systems called mission critical systems. And the only safe state for them is when they complete their mission. And here, our best choice is to use redundancy. So we duplicate the system modules to eliminate single points of failure. And sometimes those single point of failure may be hard to spot and not connected with hardware or even software. And what redundancy means for our CPUs? We use more than one CPU, and you may associate that with increased performance. But in safety critical systems, multi-CPU architecture means even lower performance, but what we gain is more safety and more control. The simplest solution for that is a system with a supervisor CPU, where we have one processor which is responsible for all the tasks of the system, and we have second CPU which checks its inputs and outputs, and if it detects that something goes wrong, it can stop the system. Second, more complex solution is to have two independent channels which have the same inputs, outputs, and even internal modules. Those internal modules exchange data between each other, and if one channel detects that data are different by some threshold, it can take some corrective action. The third, most complex case is to use a voting system where we have even more independent channels that goes into this voting system which selects final output. Here, of course, we must also think about redundancy, so our voting system is not a single point of failure. And this is exactly the way how it's used in, for example, avionics or spaceships. And regarding those independent channels, there is one interesting thing called diverse programming. It means that every channel is developed by independent software team, and those teams don't communicate with each other. They only share the same requirement, the same documentation. And this is because we want to reduce risk of having the same software errors in every channel. So we prevent bugs like from Ariane 5 from happening. And we can do this diversification in many ways. We can, for example, use different hardware, for example, CPU families, different programming languages, or some different techniques. The next issue is random events. There are some things that may happen about which in normal system we just don't care. And the one example of that is cosmic radiation. If it happens in our system, okay, we couldn't do much about it. But if we work, for example, for NASA and we create the system for millions and millions of dollars which will work in space where cosmic radiation is a thing, it would be silly to not protect against that. And I saw some statistics from NASA claiming that for a system working in space, incidents involving cosmic radiation happens every 20, 30 minutes. So it's not that uncommon. And what may be consequence of that random events? This is Constantine mission from NASA in 1992. The objective was to explore further planets of the solar system. And after about half a year, operator lost control over the shuttle, and one of the engines was on full speed, second not. So the shuttle started to rotate rapidly. And after a few minutes, operator regained control, but almost all of the fuel were burned and mission couldn't be completed. The system lacked some basic mechanism called watchdog, which is responsible for resetting system if it doesn't respond for some time. But NASA learned on its mistakes, and a few years later, in 1997, they had another mission called Pathfinder, which placed this rover on Mars. And again, there were a software error. This rover contained a deadlock, making it impossible for operator to continue mission. But this time, watchdog was in place, so NASA was able to reset the system, remotely update the software for the device located on Mars and continue mission. Simple as that. Okay, so how we protect from those random events? We can also use some runtime tests or sanity checks. They also protect from some hardware errors. We do RAM tests where we write some patterns into our memory to detect some dead bits or coupling between memory cells. We have non-volatile memory tests where we check with CRC checksums. We have also CPU tests where we check registers with similar patterns to RAM, and we have also tests for instructions, which are similar to unit tests of every assembly instruction. We have also tests for other components like power supply, sensors, or clock system. Another thing is code reuse. This is very tempting because we can save a lot of time by using some existing library or our code from another project. But we must know that we also have some problems with this software, which will be then our problems. This is something that developers of Ariane 5 rocket forgot. And software standards know about this issue. They have even specific name for the software, SOAP, Software of Unknown Provenance. And the main issues with that kind of software is that probably it doesn't fit into the software standards that we must comply with. So they have insufficient documentation, no risk assessment, we don't know about development or testing procedures. And if we cannot use that software by itself, we must provide those missing documents on our own. And it turns out that doing so for open source libraries may be even more expensive than buying really expensive commercial libraries dedicated for safety critical systems. Okay, last thing is money. It's said that safety critical systems are up to 10 times more expensive than normal systems. Unfortunately, I don't have hard data on that, so I don't know how it was measured, if it's only time to first release or for the whole life cycle, because as we know, in normal development, we can postpone some expenses into maintenance. But I have some data for avionics. And here you have comparison of various design assurance levels. Design assurance level A is the most strict. And for this, lines of code per hour for experienced developer are 12, and for not experienced developer is 3. And as you can see for level D, the values are a few times larger. Of course, it doesn't mean that developer writes only 3 or 12 lines of code per hour. This is lines of code of final production code divided by all of the activities, including not only programming, but also testing, designing, meetings, workshops, and so on. Here we have distribution of those activities. And as you can see, for all of the levels, most of the tasks are at similar levels, but the biggest difference is during verification. This is, of course, this don't mean that we do verification at the end and all of the additional costs are at the end. Verification means design reviews, code reviews, testing, etc. And we do it continuously throughout all of that project. Okay, to conclude my presentation, I will answer the question, should we be afraid of the software regulation? Because if such an authority as Uncle Bob are scaring us, maybe it's a thing. I am working with software norms for a few years, and I can say that in many ways, it's beneficial for a developer because as I showed you here, norms have set of advised techniques that in many cases we want to use even if we are not doing safety critical system. And many times there are some pressure from management, timing consideration or money, and we couldn't do that. And for safety critical systems, we just must do it because otherwise, product won't be certified. Of course, there are some downsides like excessive documentation or bureaucracy or some additional restrictions, but in the end, it's not that bad. Here on my blog, you can see some articles in English. There are only two of them now. There are more in Polish, You can also follow me on Twitter, and that's all that I have for you today. Thank you for your attention.